Well, thanks, Peter. Thanks very much. Well, it's a pleasure to be here again in St. Petersburg. Well, last time was not so long ago, was last December, right? In actually at the occasion of the La Mecha. So I speak about Gaussian exponential sums, and what I'm going to tell you about is joint work with Sasha Fedotov, who is sitting right there in the second right. Well, it's at least the setup is quite simple, as you're going to see, so I hope it'll make for a pleasant talk. So I'll first speak about what we call the renormalization of exponential sums. Actually, we're not the only ones to call it that. So I'll give a brief introduction on exponential sums, very simple ones. I'll tell you a bit about the Poisson formula, at least in this setting. You'll see what the curly Qs are, then I'll go to, that's one thing I should have done, which is, let's leave it this way. I'll try to touch the pad a few times so as not to have the screensaver come on. And so then I speak about the main question, which is the growth of exponential sums, and I present a few theorems, and as you'll see, it's going to be, I mean, at least if you do not go too deep into the details, quite simple. So what are we talking about? Something quite simple. We take sum of the exponential function, so e of z is e to the 2 pi I z, taken at some real values, right? And the real values will in general, so these are also called Weylian sums, will in general be computed as the values of some real coefficient polynomial of degree k at the integers, right? And what we are interested in is the behavior of this function s of n and p. Fix the p and let n go to infinity and study this depending on p. Well, such sums actually come up in many areas of mathematics, right? So, for example, in ergodic theory, it is using sums like this that Hermann Weyl, proved the equidistribution of numbers. If you take the sequence n alpha mod 1, but not only n alpha. If you take the sequence, he considered it was n alpha is clear, but also alpha n squared, alpha p of n, right? Take alpha an irrational number. P is a polynomial of n, and what he supposed is that, let's say, degree k and its highest degree, you take P of n and the term, the coefficients of highest degree, you don't take it to 1, you take it to be alpha, right? And then he proved equidistribution modulo 1 of the values of P of n, right? And he used exponential sums for that. It comes up in number theory, and in particular, computing the solutions to Diophantine equations, right? If you want to compute the number of solutions to Diophantine equations, there was a method which is called the Hardy-Littlewood circle method that was developed by Hardy-Littlewood in the early 20th century, where they used estimations on these exponential sums to compute the number of solutions. So it was also one of the basic tools to, I think it's Hilbert's fifth problem, right? Which was exactly to understand, if you look at Diophantine equations, so equations of the following type. I mean, oh yeah, here I got some white chalk. That's fine. Thanks, Peter. You want to solve nj of k, j equals 1 to p. And this is equal to, I don't know, n, and you want to know fix k, find p, such that for any n, or any n large enough, this has a solution, there exists n1, 2 np integers such that you can solve this equation, right? So that's a Diophantine equation, and you'd like to number to know, for example, if you fix a k, so fix the power here, what's the minimal number of variables you should take in this equation so as to be able to solve this equation either for any n or for n large enough. Hilbert's problem was for NEN, I think, but then it turned out that N large enough is the interesting problem in the sense that there are trivial obstructions if you take small n's, right, and large k's. So, and this is called Waring's problem, right? And well, it was proved in Lagrange, by Lagrange in the 18th century, that if you take k equal to, you need to take p larger than 4. Of course, if you have it for 1p, taking everybody to 0, right, for larger p's, you're happy it also works for higher p's, right? So what you're really interested in is the smallest possible p, right, in solving this. And if I remember well, k equal 3, you need, and then I don't remember actually, if it's p, it's p is equal to 9 or 19, I don't remember. But this is the content of Hilbert's
9.
Okay, that's fine. And 4 is 19, right?
Yes.
Okay. P needs to be larger than 9. And k equals 4. P needs to be larger than 19, and so on. And well, this is the case when you wanted to solve for all n. This is for all n. The numbers are different if you want to solve it only for all large enough n. Right? You don't care about small n's, but for all n's that are large enough, then you get different exponents. And as far as I remember, the problem is solved for all k except k equals 3, where I think the number of variables needed for this equation to be solvable for all n large enough is not known yet, right? I'm not a number theorist, so this is really ahead. It's not known yet. And in particular, it's due to the fact that there are no good enough estimations of what the behavior of this sum is when you take p here to be n to the cube. Right, p of n to be alpha n to the cube for a given alpha irrational. Okay. It also comes up in a harmonic analysis because what you're looking at here is lacunary series, right, in terms of the coefficients of the polynomial P. And it comes up in the analysis of PDEs, both linear and nonlinear, in particular on manifolds, because many cases actually the P of n happen to be eigenvalues of some operators, right, which can be plugged in there. So this comes up if you look at the Schrödinger semigroup, for example, or the wave semigroup of some operators on manifolds, right, the linear case. So, and one of the basic questions is the behavior of SNP when n goes to infinity, right? So we'll concentrate on what is called the Gaussian case, meaning k equals 2, the simplest case, okay? And so the sums we will be looking at will be sum from 0 to n minus 1 of, well, e to the 2 pi I times this polynomial, depending on two parameters, right? We took out the constant, a and b. And we'd like to say something about, well, how does this grow depending on a and on b, okay? But what happens is that, so this is a long-standing, I mean, studying these sums has been open for a long time, right? There have been works on this for a long time. So Hollywood paper, this famous paper is 1914. And but there was some renewal, where of course people didn't stop studying this, but there was some renewal at the beginning of the 80s when people started playing around with computers because of the things I'm going to show you now. So let's take b equals 0. So we just look at this sum, right? And people started plotting the graphs of this sum. So what do I mean by the graphs? It's just the following thing. What you do is plot the path of Sn, right? Meaning you take the integers n, 1, 2, 3, and so on, and you do linear interpolation between the values taken by this sum. So first vector, this is S0, start at 0. S1 is just this vector of length 1, right? S2, you add another vector of length 1, S3, another one, and so on. And you get a discretized curve. So this is, of course, the end. So the end of each arrow is the value of the sum for the given n, right? And I just plot the different values, and I attach them with segments. Okay, and now let me show you what's happening when you do this for more values, right? Okay, so therefore, I do the following thing. What do I want? Okay, full screen. So here you have a few values, and let's see what's happening to this curve when I go on. So here it's plotting things, so you see how the thing moves. Well, maybe I can slow it down a bit. I let it run and then I slow it down so that you can see better what's going on. So here you see how the vectors are being added, right? And they, one thing that you see is that it seems to form spirals, right? And then go from one spiral to another one, spirals. But the funny thing is that there are also bigger spirals, right? So in the early 80s, people started playing with micro. Of course, I mean, Hardy Littlewood, right? They will not sum up by hand 10,000 terms of the sum to see that this happens. Okay, but once you got a computer, it's very easy to program, right? And these pictures come out all alone. Okay, let me show you the same thing, but a little bit later. So what's happening if you do it here? This is what's happening. So it's the same parameters as before, same A and B, B equals zero and same A. And so people started wondering, well, you see this picture, where do they come from, right? Why does the sum look like this, right? Why does it look like this? And actually, interestingly enough, this is how we got dragged into this as well with Sasha. Sasha, I think if I remember well the story, you went to some number theorist talk where you saw these. Michel Mendes-France, exactly, where you saw this picture. So let me show you another one where things are slightly different. So here you see, you have still something which looks like a spiral, but if you look at this one, this portion is not spirally anymore, right? Do not see a spiral. It's the same thing, A is different, B is still zero, but it forms spirals, and you can look at it.
Can you give some idea of the scale of these things?
So well, these are vectors, these vectors, more here is length one. No, it's not a very large picture. This is scale one. This one, it's already quite large, right? Because you have between this one, maybe you have something like 20, 30, right? But the scales are going to come up. So it's not a very large picture yet. But yeah, we can zoom out. And here we have what happens if we zoom out, right? So you still get this picture. So I don't want to let it run for an hour or so. So let's go forward. And you see that even though at small scales, here it doesn't look like spirals, at larger scales it may still look like spirals, right? And so the thing goes on, you can compute a million steps, right, and see what it looks like and how it forms and deforms. So people got interested, I mean they wanted to understand where does this come from, right? Natural thing. Of course, as I said, Hardy Littlewood never saw these pictures, so they never actually asked the questions because well, the question only comes up when you see them, right? Because they had, as I'm going to try to convince you, they had the tools actually to answer these questions already a century ago, because mathematically understanding where this comes from is not too difficult. But it's just because they didn't see the picture that they didn't have the question, right? So they had the tools, but they didn't have the question, so. Up. And one of the basic tools that they already had, and actually that's one of the basic ideas of Hardy of Littlewood and this paper, is that if you look at these sums, you can actually perform a renormalization. I'll give a precise meaning to this a little bit later. Meaning that if you take the sum, so B equals zero, SNA, then it is approximately equal to the same sum for different parameters. B now is two. Why do I put two? Actually, I could put. Well, okay, two because of change of sign, actually, that's the only thing. The two implies just a change of sign. And the new parameter A1, A is actually called the frequency, and importantly, a new number of steps, right? I'm going to explain where this formula comes from, and actually give another derivation of this formula, but, and the important thing is that, so you have two sums of the same type that are related up to a coefficient, which is just some complex number modulus 1 divided by square root of a. And the important thing is that in the second sum, there are much less terms than in the first one, because a is less than one. So instead of having n term, you only have a times n terms, right? This is the integer part. The bracket here means the integer part. And a1 is computed, well, again, the only thing, if you look at the way the sum here is written, the only thing that is important is a modulo 1, right, up to a sign, because you have a 1 half, so it's up to the sign, it's a modulo 1, that's the only thing imports, right, because if I take up to changing the sign, well, because e is 1 periodic, right, you don't see any difference. If I add 1 to a, the only thing that this comes up to is changing the sign. Okay. So when the frequency is small, a small, you have less terms in the right hand side. So if the frequency is less, as the frequency is less than one, because it's only modulo one, you count things, you have less terms in the right hand side. And moreover, the other thing is that the right hand side varies slowly. When a is small and n varies by one, this only varies by actually zero because of the integer part. Right? So it stays fixed. The n1 stays fixed for a large interval of n's. Okay? So this was noted, actually, Hardy and Littlewood had such a formula. And the thing is, of course, here there's the twiddle, which means approximately equal, but of course it means that this equals this plus some remainder term. And one of the basic problems that Hardy and Littlewood had and their successors, for example, Mordell, is estimating this remainder term. Right? So where does this formula come from? What I want to say is that what you have is that you see this sum is the same, almost the same, except that here you have A1 instead of A. And so now N1 is moving much slower than N, so in some way you are erasing details, right? So what you're doing exactly is zooming out of your picture, and you forget about smaller details, right, for a sum. This is why it's called renormalization. Okay. Poisson formula. The basic thing that Hardy and Littlewood thought about is that you have this sum, you can think of it as a Fourier series, right, and apply to it the Poisson summation formula. Right? So, well, what does it say? If you take some function f, which is Schwarz class, then we know that the sum of the Fourier transform of f applied at the integer multiples of 2 pi is equal to the sum of f applied at the integers, taken at the integers. Right? And you can do this, of course, here I did it for Schwarz class, you can do it for more general things as long as these sums make sense. So what Hardy and Littlewood did, they took this function, which depends on large n. Right, just take your e to the, well, I forgot, there's no I here, actually. Ax squared, right, the I is already inside the function little e. So e to the ax squared over 2, and you truncate it at value x equals n. So this side is going just to be the exponential sum you want to compute. Right? And then you compute the Fourier transform of this thing. Well, the Fourier transform, if you do it, you'll see that you get the part coming from here, which is, again, a Gaussian, right? Fourier transform of Gaussian is not a Gaussian. But, of course, you have to change the frequency. Times a cutoff, which comes from the fact that you'd have the cutoff here. Times, or plus, some error term, right? Which, of course, depends both on the frequency and on n. Right, and then you plug this in here, right? And of course the problem is to understand what's happening to this error term, because you have error terms all the way on this side. Okay. But nevertheless, this yields, at least if the frequency A is not too badly chosen, to a formula like this with an error term that you can estimate. Right? This is where this formula comes from. Actually, this formula is, if you know about theta functions, right, you know that there are summation rules for theta functions. Right? Theta functions are nothing but exponential sums of this type, but when the frequency has an imaginary part which is non-trivial to make the thing summable. Right? In which case, the function that you are summing here, the f, is not just the oscillating exponential, it's a decaying exponential, which means that these sums really make sense, meaning that the f in this case is really Schwarz class, right? And you don't need to truncate things. You get really the transformation formulas for theta functions is exactly the Poisson formula applied to some Schwarz class functions. So here is just a truncated version of that. This is actually why Hardy and Littlewood, I guess, thought about this. So the basic formula is to have this equal to a new sum of the same type plus error terms. So the questions are how to describe the error terms. Well, are the error terms, write them this way, really error terms in the sense, are they really small? In which cases are they small? And how do they behave? So we proposed a new way to do this, right? At least, well, actually, we found out later that it was not so new. There's someone there, it was already in the literature, right? The formula that we wrote down was in the literature in the 40s.
It's not in this form.
Not in this form, but it's Jens Markloff who pointed this out to us, well, maybe 6 months or a year after the paper was published, that he found this in the literature.
The letter of Ripieri was roughly the following. We are studying this problem for many years. We haven't never seen a formula like this.
Exactly. But Jens actually dug out some reference, the literature, mathematical literature of the 30s, and by someone famous. I don't remember who it was, because I didn't. And so the thing I would have, 2 years ago, I would have said it's new. Well, now I know it's not that new, right? It's at least 70 years old. But the idea is the following. Consider the following special function. Take this kernel. So we take our oscillating exponential, okay? And you take essentially the periodic analog of the Hilbert kernel, and you integrate this exponential function multiplied by this kernel, right, along this line in the complex plane, right? So just take this complex integral. So the angle pi over 4 guarantees that this along the line goes to 0 exponentially fast, actually quadratically exponentially fast, at infinity, so making this integral well-defined, right? This integral is well-defined. And of course, because the thing here, right, the kernel is essentially one periodic in psi, well, you can expect that this one is not too far from being one periodic. It's not going to be one periodic, but the effect of this is that this integral, which is a special function, is going to satisfy nice equations. So first, it's easy to show that this is an entire function just by contour deformation, right? That this is an entire function of the variable xi. Right? It's defined actually on the whole complex plane, and it's holomorphic on the whole complex plane. For a positive, fix a positive, and it satisfies the following, well, actually it satisfies two finite difference equations. First, if you compare what happens, if you look at the difference f of xi minus f of xi minus 1, it is equal to the exponential function. Right? This, well, we have it here, I rewrote f here. This just comes from the fact that if you take xi, xi minus 1, you are shifting, you are comparing integral along two straight lines, parallel straight lines, right, of the same function. And the kernel on these two lines, because of the one periodicity of this kernel, oops, sorry, the kernel on these two lines is the same. So what you can use, you can just use the residue theorem to close the contours here, and you get the residue inside, right? And the residue is easily computed from the explicit formula. The second equation is, well, almost as clear, up to the change of variable. It just comes from a change of variable. You just do up to the change of function here. It just comes from a change of variable. Z gives P minus Xi, you put this in here, change the contour, expand it, right? Just expand the squares, and you see that you satisfy this equation. So you have this function that satisfies, up to modulo this term, two non-trivial first order finite difference equations.
At the same time.
At the same time, yeah, the same function satisfies these two equations. And there is another relation that is going to be useful, which again is obtained by a change of variable in here and by a residue theorem, right? So it's just very simple computations, right? Integral evaluation in the complex plane using the residue theorem and some simple change of variables. Well, and now using this, we are going to prove the following renormalization formula. So fix a number of steps n, fix A and B. And let C be the fractional part of A times n. N1 is the integer part of A times n. A1 is the new frequency parameter, meaning 1 over A modulo 1. And B1 is, well, a transformation of B modulo 1, but you take its representation, its representative in -1/2, 1/2. Right? Instead of taking it modulo 1 in 0, 1, you take the representative in -1/2, 1/2. Okay? And you have the following transformation. The sum Sn AB is a coefficient C of A, which is just the e to the -1/8 divided by square of A, times some complex number of modulus 1, times the sum Sn1 A1 B1, plus a remainder term, which is now expressed exactly in terms of our special function. So, as I said, such formulas were known to Hardy-Littlewood, but not the remainder term, well, except for what I just said before, that actually someone already had such formula.
For B non-zero.
Yeah, this one, they looked at B non-zero, okay?
For B equal to zero.
For B equal to zero, right? You see what's going to happen, right? It's just you have this change. So here you take 1 over A modulo 2. So it means that you just have a change of 1/2 minus 1/2. But if you put it in here because of 2 pi, it's just a change of sign in the sum, right? So it means that essentially the B, if you take B equals 0, you just have a new change of sign in here, right? This is the only thing that it induces. Okay. How do you prove this? It's very simple. You take the function g I introduced before, and if you look, because of the equation g satisfies, right? If you look at the sum that you want to evaluate, it is just, well, actually, sum, not exactly the one we want to evaluate, but almost the one you want to evaluate, is just the sum for g at, it's just a difference between g at na minus b and g at minus b. And this sum, if you expand the square, you see that it's a very simple multiple of the true sum you are interested in. Right? So in this way, you get a nice expression for Sn in terms of g of na minus b and minus g of minus b. But then using the definition of g in terms of S, you can re-express this in terms of F. And for F, you can use the one, the other difference equation, right, to compute this difference. Right, this is just using, this difference equation. So you take Na, reduce it modulo minus 1 and so on, up to Xi, as Xi is Na modulo 1, right, by definition. So you get this. The number of terms you have here is now N1, because if you look at the integer part, right, N1 is just the integer part of Na. That's the number of ones that you can actually subtract from Na and get still something between 0 and 1, which is the Xi. Okay, and you'd look at the explicit formulas which are obtained by f of Xi plus 1 comma b. This is in, what did I do? This is comma a here, there's no b here. That's a, it's the same thing. Right, that's an a here. There's something I should correct. There's only one f. And then, well, you recompute just this term, right, simple computation. Well, right, using modulo 1, okay, k square, right, and like this way, 1/2, so you have 1/2 to kill the one that you added. Okay, And you finally get that f n b, and this is no b, this is an a again, right, is equal to this side that you recomputed using this computation. Yes. And you express it in terms of g, or g, sorry, where do we have g? No, actually, you don't even need to express anything anymore, because you just take this one, right, this is expressed, you just plug this thing into here. You just plug this thing into here, and you complete the proof. Right, that's the only thing. You don't need even expressing g in terms of f, you just take this formula, and you plug it in here. Right, and you reduce the squares, some things simplify, and, well, you get the proof of your renormalization formula. Well, let's now understand the analysis of the curlicues. What does it explain on the pictures that we saw before? First, one can compute semi-classical asymptotics for f in the limit when a is small. So fix c between minus 1/2 and 1/2, and take a between 0 and 1. When a is small, you can actually prove that f of c and a asymptotically behaves like some coefficient of modulus 1 times, well, the, what is this called? The Fresnel integral, right? Times the Fresnel integral expressed at a to the minus 1/2 times c, right? That's, well, you use just asymptotic evaluation of your function, right? When you integrate it along this complex curve, you use the steepest descent method, right, to get this. And if you plot the graph of f, you get this, right? That's the graph of the Fresnel integral, right? So it bears some similarity to what we saw before, right? How comes? Well, the explanation is the following. Make it simple, set b equals 0. Take c, remember c is a times n modulo 1, and n1 is the integer part of a times n. a1 is 1 over a modulo 1. So remember, we have this formula. This is for b equals 0, we get this formula, right? Now take a to be small. Then, as I said, when n varies, when the number n varies, a times n has a constant integer part over an interval of n's of size 1 over a, right, roughly. Then over this interval, the only thing, so n1 stays the same, the only thing that varies is xi, which is the fractional part of a times n modulo 1. And how does it vary? It varies by increments of size a, right? Every time you add 1, you change n by 1, this gets incremented by a. A is small, right? And therefore, if you look at this function, right? If you, here, a1 is fixed, n1 over such an interval stays fixed as well. So this is just a constant. So the only thing when you vary n that varies is actually this side. Right? But this one, how does it vary? If you use the asymptotic formula, because a is small, what you see is that this just is obtained, well, this by the asymptotic formula is equal or approximately equal to the Fresnel integral evaluated at a fixed number, right? This is xi times a minus 1, given value. But here you have a to the 1/2 coming from the k, a times a to the minus 1/2, a to the 1/2 times k. So when k varies, right, you vary n by k steps. Oops. Now I have to go through the whole thing again. Oops, yeah, here I was. So when k varies now, one by one, this f gets incremented by, the argument of f gets incremented by a to the 1/2, but a is small. So it gets incremented by small arguments. So what you see, instead of getting the curve, you get an approximation of this curve. How good is the approximation depends on A. If A is very small, it's going to be a very good approximation. And, well, what is this? This is the Gauss map, right? 1 over A modulo 1 is the Gauss map. So it's well known that if you do this renormalization at the J step, what you get is just the J's continued fraction, right? Or the J's, what is it called now in number theory? Yeah, the J's element, thanks very much. It's the J's element of the continued fraction giving A. When is this A J small? It's when Nj here is large, right? So the pictures that I showed you before were the following ones. In the first example, I took N0 to be large, N1 to be large, N2 to be large. And so what I got, just to show you again, I got spirals at every level. At the small level, if you remember, we had spirals, then we had a second level of spirals, then we have a third level of spirals, and each of these levels corresponds to this 1 over n, or this n being large, right? Whereas, in the second example, I only have spirals at a higher level. Right here, at the small level, I don't have spirals. Why? It's because if you look at what parameters I took, well, of course, it's a computer, right? So I don't have any irrational numbers, right? I only have rationals, but here I go pretty far. I took just one of the n's to be large. So it's only after a certain number of renormalization steps that I'm going to be in this asymptotic mode when A is very small, and that I really have a good approximation to the Fresnel integral. Okay? And so in this way, you can compute all the characteristics of the spirals in terms of A. They're all given by these asymptotic formulas and just the continued fraction expansion of A. Right? This explains everything for these pictures. Right. The second thing is the growth of the exponential sum. Well, let's start with a short preliminary, which is very simple. I can compute the integral from 0, 1, so fix b, and take your exponential sum modulo squared and integrate with respect to a. You integrate over the frequencies. So you expand this square, you get a diagonal term, which is when you have one of the exponentials multiplied by its complex conjugate, which gives you 1, so you get n diagonal terms, and you have the off-diagonal terms that all integrate out to 0, right? Because they are just integrals of exponentials, right, over one period. So they integrate out to 0. So you see that this integral is actually equal to n. So what you see is that even though the sums have n terms in them, the typical value for such a sum is rather of size square root of n, right? If you integrate it square, for most of the a's, this is going to look like square root of n. The number of values for which it's going to be much larger is going actually to be small. So what you expect is that this is going to be of size square root of n. Well, let me give two theorems that are actually coming from the renormalization formula I presented before. We consider first the typical a and b. So take any function that is non-increasing. Then for almost every a and b, right, parameters, the lim sup of the quotient Sn divided by square root of n, which is what you expect, times g, this function of log of n, is finite if and only if the sum of the 6 powers of g at the integers is going to be finite. What does it mean? It means roughly that if you take the function phi of n log n to the 1/6, then the ratio of this does not grow slower than phi to the 1. Well, actually, I should have written phi to the 1 minus 0, right? And it doesn't grow faster than phi to the 1 plus 0, right? So the thing grows typically of order log n to the 1 6. This ratio between Sn square root of n grows like log n to the 1 over 6. Okay, this is what happens for typical A and B. But there are untypical ones that can be studied as well. So if you take this set of real numbers, so this is just the fractional part modulo 1, but taken inside minus 1 half, 1 half. If you fix an irrational number A, you can check that this set B of A is dense in minus 1 half, 1 half easily. It's just because of the density of this in R. And then for almost all A in 0, 1, you can find a dense G delta set of B's that contains this set of numbers, such that for B in this dense G delta set, the growth rate now is not anymore a logarithm to the 1 6, it's going to be logarithm to the 1 4th. Yeah, well, roughly. This is the precise statement, right? That's the theorem, but it means that the thing is going, so it goes in a different way, right? So you have, and of course, if you pick some particular rational numbers, it's still going to be different, right? If you pick particular rational numbers, in some cases it can not grow at all, and in some cases it can actually grow like n. But of course, these numbers are pretty rare, right? So you get many types of growth, but the typical ones are described by this, right? So how late is it, by the way?
Five minutes to six.
Okay, I have 20 minutes, so that's fine. Okay, so what I wanted to explain to you is where do these results come from? How do you do this, right? And it's how it can be, or how it is done based on the renormalization formula. The basic idea is to use the renormalization formula to map the growth properties of the function Sn divided by square root of n to some statement on a dynamical system, right? A special dynamical system. This is what I'm going to explain now. So therefore, what we're going to do is we're going to apply the renormalization formula multiple times, right? We did it one because we find another sum of the same type. You can renormalize it using the same formula once again, and so on, okay? And of course, this naturally leads to the following dynamical system. A0 gets transformed into A1, AL gets transformed into AL plus 1 through the Gauss map, B0 gets transformed into B1, and BL gets transformed into BL plus 1 through this map, right? That's what these are coming out of the renormalization formula. And of course, the number of terms in the sum gets transformed in the following way. Right, so it's just the L plus first number, L plus after L plus 1 renormalization, the sum contains a number of terms that is equal to the integer part of AL, the frequency at rank L, times the number of terms the sum contained at step number L. Okay, so this sequence here is strictly decreasing because the ALs are between 0 and 1. And it stops decreasing when it takes values 0. At some point, you have no terms in the sum anymore, and you can't renormalize. There's nothing to renormalize, right? So you have to stop. Okay? So you can say that there is, for a given n, there is a stopping time, right? When the series, you can't do any more renormalization. And let's call this stopping time L of n, right? You can apply your renormalization formula until you have done L of n times for a given n. Of course, this L depends on A. Right? Because this thing here is determined by A. And what you can do is you can apply the renormalization multiple times to get a formula for SNAB. And of course, the only thing that is going to be left is the remainder terms. Right? The only thing that's left. So the precise formula is not important. I'm going to come with a formula that is more understandable. But the only thing I want to show you is that what you get is a sum of remainder terms obtained at each step. Remember, The A L's here, they're all less than one. So even though I have a sum of many terms, not all bear the same importance, because this product, of course, is going to go to zero. So its inverse is going to be large. And so actually, that's a result by Kenshin and Levy. It's going to be exponentially large, and the exponential A almost surely for the Lebesgue measure on 0, 1. And the exponential, right, the coefficients of this exponentially large is a constant, which is called the Hinchin constant, if I remember well, right? And which does not depend on A almost surely, okay? And so this is, so you see that the term that really plays the most important role is going to be the one at ln, right? Which has the most product, most terms in this product. A's are small, so the product, the inverse of the product is big. And, well, what you can do is the following thing. So you can now, so we want to study what happens with our Sn when n goes to infinity. What we are going to do is we are going to take the half line of the integers and split it into pieces, right? And roughly, each piece will correspond to the integers for which you have to do the same number of renormalization to hit the value zero. Right? And to define this, well, you take the minimal integer such that after L steps you hit zero, right? And the maximal integer such that after N steps you hit zero, right? N renormalization steps. And of course you can show that they are consecutive, right? At the next step, right? It's going to be what is called partition of through these integers. You can partition the whole set of integers, right? And what else do you have? You have an estimate of this number using the product of the ALs, right? And using this, what you can show is that if after L steps you define xi to be equal to this, right? Because this, you don't need any integer, you don't need any fractional parts anymore, because this has been done in such a way that this number is less than one. If you want, this is roughly the definition of NL, right? That this number be less than one. You can get asymptotic formulas for Sn AB divided by square root N in terms of the Fresnel integral. Right? So maybe I can draw a small picture. You have the integer axis. Right, and we have split it into pieces such that here you need L steps of renormalization, L plus one steps, and so on. Right, and over each piece, when you're inside such a piece, which is what this means, what you can get is an asymptotic formula for the renormalized sum in terms of these numbers, right? They're precisely here. What their value is not so important, right? And you see what is important is that this comes, say this actually, what comes into play is the value xi and al and bl. What happens to my sequences a and b after L steps of renormalization? This is what determines how large this quotient, or how small it is going to be. Okay? And from this, what we obtain is the following. If now you call the maximal value of this, of the Sn divided by square root n over this interval, then you can show that you can find two constants independent of A and B, such that this maximal value is bounded from above always by this number. And if this number is large, it's also bounded by below, by the same number, up to a constant. Okay? And so, what did you want to measure? What you wanted to measure is, what are the excursions? You want to understand, when does this thing go to infinity or not? So what this is telling you is that whether this goes to infinity or not is going to be measured just by the values AL and BL. Right? Whether this is very large or very small compared to where the sum, the exponential sum, is very large or very small compared to square root of n, is just measured by these two things. So naturally, now what you want to understand is what happens to the values, the dynamical system in R2, or actually in not R2, but in some square in R2, defined before, right? You want to understand what's happening after renormalizations, what's happening to this dynamical system, how does it behave, right? So what we just did is reduce the study of the exponential sum for values a and b to understand after n steps to understanding what's happening for the behavior of this dynamical system, right? Well, so we need to study this dynamical system, and I'm just present two results on this. So the first is a Gauss map, so it's well known what's happening, right, for this one, and for B it's something which is more complicated, but depending on the Gauss map. So, and now take a trajectory of the dynamical system, right? So it's a sequence of AL, BL. And now define N of L phi AB to be the number of times square root of 4 AL has become smaller than phi L, and square root of B L, or modulus BL, has become smaller than phi L. Remember why these things? It's because this is roughly saying when did this become larger than phi 1 over phi L, right? Or 1 over 2 phi L, actually, if you do the sum. When did this thing become larger than 1 over 2 phi L? So here we are estimating the number of times this thing is the number of times this condition has been satisfied between 0 and L. Okay, so you're estimating how many times in the L first renormalization, or if you want, when you take N in here, how many times did Sn divided by square root of N become larger than phi N? 1 over phi N, because you have to invert this. Okay. And we want to study, well, how many times it does happen. So what you prove over this system is the following thing. You can introduce, that's the state space for A and B, right? This is preserved by the transformation. So it's the state space of our dynamical system. And you can look at the N1 norm in A and B and the L2 norm of this number, right? And so the just of this function of A and B. And what you prove is the following thing. You prove that if the function, the non-increasing function, satisfies that its sixth power is summable, then the soup of the L1 norms of this is going to be finite, right? The soup over all L of the L1 norm of this is going to be finite. What does it mean? It means that for most A and B here, roughly, you say that the soup is roughly estimating, that this L1 norm is roughly estimating the size of NL for most A and B. For most A and B, right, this number is going to be finite, right? But if for most A and B this number is finite, it means that at infinity, the thing cannot grow anymore, because the fact that the Sn divided by square root of N is large is exactly the fact that, or larger than phi L, is exactly this condition. One over phi L. Phi L is small, right? And so here this essentially gives the first, well, one part of the first theorem. And the other part is that if this sum diverges, if you're not in this case, then what happens is that the L2 norm of NL and the L1 norm are approximately the same when L goes to infinity. What's the use of this? The use is the following thing. If you know that the L1 norm and the L2 norm of a function are the same, then it means that almost surely the function is constant and equal to its L1 norm. These are non-negative functions, right? They're counting functions, right? It's just this, right? Okay. Right? So if x is a counting function, it's not negative, right? Here we're saying that this, this is L2 norm, so there is a square root, so that's the L2 norm square, right? It's equal to the L1 norm square, so this is zero, means that E is equal to x is equal to E of x, almost surely, right? That's the only thing. And so what does it mean? It means that at infinity, when L is large, then this thing actually behaves as it behaves like this L1 norm. But we know that when this diverges, then this L1 norm has to diverge. So almost surely, there'll be infinitely many excursions, right, above the value, which proves the other part of the theorem. Okay, and I think my time is over, and I stop here.
Let's thank the speaker.
I hope I wasn't too technical in the end.
Questions, remarks?
Do you have something similar for cubic sums?
I'd like to, but no, I don't. You see, the basic thing is here. The basic thing is here. Oops, where is it? It's not here, it's already, yeah. Is here. The basic thing is that the Gaussian, its Fourier transform is a Gaussian again, right? If you take, right, the basic thing is that the Legendre transform of x squared is constant times x squared, right? And for cubes, it's not true anymore. So really, a randomization formula is really the Poisson formula, right? There is no, that's correct. The only thing is to estimate the remainder terms, right? So, to my knowledge, for the cube, well, this is not the case. There are other methods to estimate, I mean, there are other methods to estimate these sums, right? Which is really number theoretical methods, which actually the idea is to get estimates on the sums. What we're going to take is modulus of the sum to some power, right, take the integral of this and try to evaluate this integral. Okay, and well, this is what is called the circle. That's the circle method of Hardy and Littlewood, right? And these are very difficult number theoretical estimates, right? Usually what they are done using rational frequencies, right? You assume that omega A is rational with certain properties, and you show that in neighborhoods of this rational thing, you can estimate as well by, well, actually something quite tricky. Okay, so many people have worked on this, I mean, and it's really hard work and analytic number theory work, right? But for the cube, it's such a method, no, we tried, of course we tried it, but up to now, no. There is another approach to this, which is, I mean, there was a recent paper by Jens Markloff and what's the name of his collaborator, do you remember?
His collaborator.
And his collaborator. Where they do the following thing. Again, they map the dynamic, they map the sum, right, in a way similar to this one, to another dynamical system. And actually, that's an idea that goes back to Markloff's thesis. Well, it must be almost 15, maybe 20 years old. But he could not do it for the true sums, meaning with a truncation at finite size. He could do it with a regularized sum if instead of truncating, taking finitely many terms, you, for example, take some smooth function, right? You take e to the 2i pi x times phi of x, which is a nice Schwarz function, phi of n divided by epsilon, and you let epsilon go to zero, which makes your function go to one. Okay, so here, if you imagine here we are doing the Fourier transform with a truncation, which is this. What you can do is Fourier transform with a truncation which is nice and smooth, and here the remainder term estimates are really good. So, but recently they managed to use their method to do Fourier transform with a truncation like this. And in this case, which is a very nice idea, what they did is they mapped the behavior of the sum to a dynamical system which is homogeneous on the hyperbolic sphere, right? Which is natural because it is linked directly to the Gauss map, right? The Gauss map, it's well known that it can be represented using homographies, right, on the hyperbolic spheres by studying. And so they really have to understand, actually it's not hyperbolic, it's on the quotient of the hyperbolic sphere. So they really study what's happening to a dynamical system when it goes into the cusps, right, on the hyperbolic sphere. And using this, they actually get a more complete picture of what's going on. Because what they can say is, there's an interesting thing, you can ask the question in a different way. So you look at Sn AB divided by square root of n, and you'd like to understand, is there some kind of limiting value? If I go to infinity, right, can I define some probability measure in the same way as, so what's the best way to put it? Yeah, you look at, well, it's not exactly Sn, you have to take the right quantity, right? But really what you'd like to understand is, if you look at, I don't remember exactly what the renormalization, yeah. You want to understand if, what they look at is something like A, oh, it's not A, alpha, AB, right? And I look at square root of n, and I want to look at the limit of this, right? I want to look at the probability distribution in A and B. So you look at this, in A and B, this is a random variable. Okay, you look at the limit of this. This is a random variable depending on alpha, and you want to understand the properties of this random variable in alpha. Right? You want to look at how these values are distributed. Okay, and using this mapping to this dynamical system on a hyperbolic sphere, disk actually, they are able to do that. Okay.
Other questions or remarks? Then let's thank the speaker again.
Well, thank you.